Can you believe that the world is still turning? Isn't that amazing? It's incredible, right? All the attempted disempowerment is still going on. It's really funny. Remember, always have a sense of humor about how ridiculous this entire situation is, because it is completely ludicrous. Now, there are a lot of people who believe that Jesus is coming back and then they'll be saved. But if that's the case, why weren't they saved the first time when he came? If all that's required is Jesus shows up and we're saved, why didn't it happen the first time? I can tell you that salvation has to do with choosing to let your thinking and thoughts and valuing and belief in time, space, process, form, letting go of the belief that you can be disempowered. That is salvation. And that takes a lot more than just Jesus showing up, because there's a continuity fear. You would certainly feel like giving it up, but then you'd say, I'm not sure I can. So that's why Jesus came first time and said, look, you need to do a lot of work and evaporate the continuity fear before you can really understand and get it. Now, the first time that Jesus came, crucified, resurrection, okay. Now, I have a clearer understanding of this. And what Jesus did was come into a world of spirit trying to, a scenario of spirit trying to disempower itself through bodies dying. And the idea that once the body dies, that proves the disempowerment of spirit. And he said, look, okay, I'll come into this world. I'll show you that even one who knows that they are the Son of God, that they are spirit, even one who knows that, okay, one who knows it perfectly well, comes here in the world and then has their body, you know, treated badly and crucified, and the body dies. And then what happens? Resurrects the body. Body's perfectly well again. And he says, you see, it did not disempower spirit. Did not disempower spirit. So if it doesn't disempower my spirit, the spirit, and we're all one spirit, it doesn't disempower yours either. Death does not disempower spirit at all. So it's just an attempt to disempower that's futile. Okay, so this I like this explanation of the crucifixion and the resurrection. And we need to take that to heart. We say, wow, even someone with full awareness of spirit. So someone had full awareness of spirit, the body still dies and doesn't disempower spirit in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. So he showed us, no. So this is something we need to take to heart. Now, we're coming up to 2:15. And I say this is an 18-month stretch, which is very crucial, because there's like a quote-unquote spiritual virus, a mental virus, let's put it, in the world, a mental virus, a virus of deception. And it's way worse than the Ebola virus. It's highly contagious. Actually, it's super contagious. super contagious. And this virus has been rampaging through the world for quite some time. And it's likely to, during the next 18 months, infect just about everybody here. And this virus, what this virus does is make us oblivious to salvation, actually. That's a bad virus to get. A very bad virus to get. It just won't register on our radar anymore. We just won't. We won't know where to look or even think about it. We'll be so into trying to make our attempts to disempower ourselves seem interesting, which is what the world is about, right? As we wait for our ultimate disempowerment, you know, the death of the body and misery and poverty and suffering, and then the body dies and all this. As we go through all this torture here, we try to make it interesting. Put some lipstick on it. So, this is the virus says, this is great. This is what we're supposed to be doing, everyone. And so everyone gets on board with that. So this is going to ramp up very, very extremely in the next 18 months. What to do about this? Get an inoculation. Inoculation. Like, so what I want to do is like try out an experimental vaccine on myself. A spiritual mental vaccine. And see if that protects me from this virus in the next 18 months. So this is a way of looking at a shift that we can make, of flipping the script. Look at it as a vaccination, as a vaccination, somewhat experimental. And say, you know what, it's worth a try. Might as well give it a try. Can't hurt. And maybe it doesn't work, but it might. So it certainly won't hurt. And it's we have a right to experiment with our lives, certainly. Other people say, no, you can't do that. Well, I have a right, you know. They wait for disempowerment, right to experiment. And maybe won't be so disempowered. Possible. Be inoculated from it. It's funny, this world is pushing every kind of inoculation possible. It'll soon be like mandatory. You can't get a job unless you've proven you have vaccinations and stuff. You can't do anything. And yet, they're also pressing very strongly that nobody gets the spiritual vaccination. They say, you must avoid that at all costs. Can't do that. Well, certainly we need to do it. I sure want to try it out. I have a right to try it out. So all this information that were given by those who have realized that disempowerment's impossible is like a vaccination. And there's some sort of flipping of the script we can do where we're in the vaccinated condition. We feel, oh, I've just been vaccinated. Look at it that way. And then, of course, when you're vaccinated, you feel something, maybe. And you maybe will start feeling like this, wow, I feel like immune to all this stuff. I've been vaccinated. This is a good way to look at it. And look at just, well, just try it for 18 months and see how it goes. That's also the way to look at it. It doesn't seem so extreme. It doesn't seem like I'm just going to leap into endless enlightenment this very instant. Yeah. Instead, say, no, I'm just going to try experimental vaccine and see how it works for about 18 months and reevaluate it. Then I'll have some hindsight to like, I'm just testing it out, like a scientist is testing it out. And we'll just see how it goes. And like that. It's a much more low-key way of looking at the situation. Doesn't feel so threatening. I just say, you know, it's worth a try. Worth a try, might as well try it. And just look at it that way. And we could say, well, it's a reversible vaccine, actually. It's a reversible vaccine. We can reverse it if necessary. So it's a reversible vaccine, trying it out, doing a trial, clinical trial here for 18 months. Very simple. But I would certainly say that it would be a very good idea to give this vaccine a trial. Thinking complex, the belief system of thought and concept, is a very tricky situation, not to be trusted at all. It's highly infectious. It can entrain, it can cause like stampedes, it can cause very easily take your eye off the prize. Very, very, very easy to take your eye off the prize. Very, very easy to settle for duality. For a nice duality, a soft landing in duality. Very easy to fall into that. So it's best not to take risks or chances. Don't try to deal with the situation at the level of thoughts and concepts. This, in my opinion, is a booby trap that we are about to fall into the next 18 months. Got to get out of thoughts, thinking, words. Have to have a true vaccination that immunizes you from that. And of course, Jesus' mission here recently has been to take us beyond words. He was very insistent. You must get there. You must go beyond that to experiencing it in some way. And this is the immunity. Because the rhetoric is, and words, etc., are easily controlled and are not stable. And you feel like you don't have a leg to stand on when you try to take certain positions, certain ideological stands with words and concepts. And this world will just pull the rug out from underneath you easily. It's all set up, actually, to do just this. And you won't have a leg to stand on. And I think then people will just get depressed. A lot of people will just sort of fall into sort of a collapsed, depressed, functioning state, which they'll try to medicate some way and try to rationalize in some way, but we don't want that. So if Jesus losing the body like that doesn't disempower his spirit at all, it doesn't disempower our spirit either. So we can just take that as a truism. And therefore we don't even need to experiment with disempowering ourselves through death at all. We can dump death, disengage from death, absolutely disengage from death. As an experiment for a while, disengage from death, absolutely. Now we may think, this may feel like panic, like a big deal. It's not a big deal to us, it's a big deal to the ego. It's a big deal to the plan of trying to disempower ourselves. But it's not a big deal for us to disengage from death. The fear is like, oh boy, if I don't have that, how can I disempower myself? It's much more difficult. Well, we're not trying to disempower ourselves anymore. So we don't really need to be engaged with death, actually. But everybody here thinks it's like some inevitability, and actually they think it's something profound and everyone has to die and all this kind of stuff. It's all nonsense. So I'm going to try to accept that immunity for myself and then see how it goes for 18 months. Certainly is a great experiment. Great time to experiment in the world right now. Really a great time to experiment in this way. Because the pressure will be on so severe, it'll be a good experiment. It'll be a really great experiment. Does this work? This will show, the pressure will be on. And it will show, does this work or not? Absolutely will show it. Because there's enormous pressure on the world right now. Enormous pressure. From really big business and what they're doing right now. And all the ways and means that they're using right now to turn us all into sheeple. And their plan is very far along, actually, very far along. And it's going according to plan. And they're very tricky at it. And it's like our hands are tied because we're not able to really speak forthrightly about the means and techniques that they're using. They sort of using fronts that are sort of sacred fronts that you're not supposed to criticize. They're using that. And it's very effective what they do. Very effective in leading us to take our eye off the prize and to keep believing that we have been disempowered. Disempowerment is possible and we're a living example of that. So certainly not everybody is lined up to, you know, take the vaccination. Not everybody's there. There are a lot of sheeple in the world now. And when the bad shepherd calls the sheeple in the world, the sheeple, there are all these sheepdogs actually in the world. And many, many border collies, sheepdogs, Belgian sheepdogs, whatever. All these sheepdogs are, yap, 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 biting at the heels and driving the sheep, and the sheep kind of go in a herd consciousness type of thing. And everybody, goes along with it. And going along to get along. Going along to get along. And so these nasty dogs barking at the sheep and hurting them, they're all over the place. They're all over the place. So, it's, anyway, disengaging from death is certainly one way to try out vaccination. Let's try out that vaccination, the disengaging from death vaccination. See how that goes. Clinical trial here. Clinical trial. So, Jesus is looking for a few volunteers to conduct a clinical trial to test out the disengagement from death vaccination, to see how it does during this period of intense pressure in the world. So here's a volunteer. I volunteer. Jesus, absolutely, I volunteer. So I'm trying to look at it. I'm trying to reframe this whole thing in a more interesting, less fearful manner here, because people seem to have great trouble. We spend lifetimes talking about light and whatever. People have a very difficult time actually get accepting it. So I find that this is a very helpful way for me to look at it. Clinical trial vaccination for this 18-month period, and see at the end of that, see how stable I am, see how I feel. So yes, I say yes to this trial, absolutely. And then of course the interns can be observing, other people can observe and say, how's it going, how's it going? The only problem is they maybe get caught up in the virus and forget all about it. We'll see, it should be interesting. Benefits of this could be down the road, because if these clinical trials work, then we realize, hey, let's start promoting what works here, and let's start getting more vaccinated against these activities of the really big business, which is an alliance of business on this planet and business from outside of this planet. It's a large alliance, actually. And their business is turning people away from salvation into sheeple. That's their business. And it suits them well, they think. Makes them feel in control. That things are lining up properly for them in a nice way. And that they can have empowerment within a context of disempowerment. You see, that's what they're hoping for, that's what they're trying for. That's duality. What we say is empowerment. Disempowerment is impossible. What they say is that disempowerment is a fact, but there's a way to have empowerment within that disempowerment, or a way to somehow combat it. That's duality. That's delusion. What we say is disempowerment has never happened. It's impossible, and thus has never happened. You don't make illusions of what can never happen real, try to make them real in your mind, and then fix them, or cure them, or get rid of them. Because that would be disempowerment. If you could make, if you think it's real and you're getting rid of something that's real, you would be disempowering yourself. So it's a trap. Duality is a trap. Making illusions, believing illusions are real, and then trying to get rid of them is playing the game of disempowerment, of course. Because we only nothing real can be threatened. So if we think we can get rid of some aspect of reality, and reality is all one, we're definitely playing the game of disempowerment. So duality, no matter how you play it, is playing the game of disempowerment. The belief system of trying to disempower ourselves, which we cannot. So it's a waste of time. Meaningless. But that's the game that is being played here, and it's enticing, isn't it? Because we think, oh, there's some way I can empower myself. And so what all this really big business is teaching is, quote unquote, empowerment teachings. That's what they're saying, empowerment teachings. And that's turning everyone into sheeple, dualistic, and it makes things worse. Because they're saying, yes, disempowerment is true, but you can empower you. Find a way, various ways to empower you. And here we go, we have these products that will help empower you. So there's all this secular humanistic materialism is this game of dualistic game of working to empower ourselves. As I said, to try and make this ultimate attempt to disempower ourselves interesting, sticking with it. Thinking like, at least I can empower myself a little bit within this greater scheme of disempowerment, like that. Yeah, I'm gonna die, but before I die, I want to at least, you know, get that car or some sort of empowerment. Yeah, we're sucked into that. We're sucked into it. That is delusion. That is delusion. That is the deluded condition. Simple as that. The enlightened perspective is, appeal perception is, no disempowerment has ever happened. No disempowerment will ever happen. Now, so all we need to do is just drop, you know, to realize this. And recognize there's no disempowerment happening anywhere. Disengage from death. Disengage from death. Disengage from disempowerment. Disengage from it. Disengage from delusion. And try it out as a clinical trial, sort of, yeah. The doctors who? Dr. Jesus is running this clinical trial. The good doctor, Dr. Jesus, is looking for volunteers. So. Now they say, well, if you disengage from death, you'll have to pay the price later on. Either you're gonna suffer severe empowerment. But they say this is like natural empowerment. Death is just part of the nature cycle of disempowerment. It's a natural disempowerment that is ultimately leading to some transformation or something. You know, it's teaching you lessons, or is it? But there's something good that will come out of this and that. And they say if you mess with this natural disempowerment, oh, terrible things will happen to you. You need to you need to be part of the natural order of things, natural order of disempowerment. You need to do that. I said, huh? What a complete nuts, this dualistic gibberish. Dualism is absolute gibberish, actually. It is. You can't make sense of it. It's nonsense. Because it's saying somehow disempowerment leads to empowerment. That's like saying getting rid of reality leads to reality. But what we're really saying is getting rid of reality leads to a greater reality, you know, which is nonsense. We're not the creators of reality. So we have to remember to laugh at this nonsense. Don't take it seriously. Big storm here today. sitting in my vehicle. The wind hit the vehicle so hard that it rocked the vehicle. I was like, never experienced that before. Boom! I said, whoa, I hit someone, hit me or something? No. Whoa. Wow, really, that really intensely gust, isolated gusts like that were just, it was intense. Like almost like a whirlwind was just swirling, just buffeting everything. Amazing. Trees came down, broken limbs, and it's a good little storm. So things are set up nicely in the world for the really for really big business to push their agenda forward. They have their blueprints. And they don't really realize that they're dualistic and how completely absurd it all is. So they're very earnest and they think that they're able to, that what they're doing is right and just and intelligent and all this stuff. But they don't understand that they're caught in this whim of duality. Again, making an illusion real, trying to make an illusion real, and then in order so that they can then get rid of it, you know, is a whimsical delusion. It's like trying to make evil real, and then in order to get rid of it, they say we just can't get rid of evil yet because we haven't quite made it real yet. We just can't get rid of disempowerment yet because we haven't made it real yet. So we just make disempowerment real, then we'll be able to, with our power over, you know, a power of over reality, we'll be able to get rid of it. Because the idea of being greater than reality, which is what started all this nonsense, is the idea we're greater in reality. So, but we can't deal with a shadow, an illusion, something that doesn't exist, you know. In other words, disempowerment doesn't exist. And so we're trying to make it real, you know, make it real. So then we can get rid of it. It's like that which has the power to destroy reality. We're trying to make it real, so then we can get rid of that which has the power to destroy reality and be the heroes. Oh, look, I saved your reality by getting rid of this power to destroy you. But we haven't been able to make it real yet. This is how ludicrous it all is. So we're trying to make the power to destroy reality real, so that then we can demonstrate that we're greater than reality, that we save reality from some power that was going to destroy it by destroying this evil destroyer of reality. And then we can say, look, you know, I saved you from destruction. I'm greater than you are. But the only fly in the ointment of this is that there is no evil force of disempowerment. There isn't any such thing situation. But we're certainly trying to make it real, aren't we? We're trying to make illusions real. And our perception is so selective, actually. Our thinking, perception, call it what you want, is like super selective. This is what Jesus tells us, super selective. And therefore, it seems as though we don't see that how ludicrous it is and see how unreal it is. We're not aware because we filtered out all the evidence. It's like body senses are basically their filters, which basically filters out all the evidence that would be contrary to what we want to see. And what we want to see is that disempowerment is real. That's what we want to see. So of course, body perception, our chosen means of perception, chosen means of delusion, is filtering out the evidence, all the evidence that it's not real. So as we see through the body senses, we are being framed, you know, framed for delusion. We don't see any evidence. Well, I can't see this. All seems real to me. This is what we've done. And all thanks to those who have told us about this. Otherwise, it would be difficult indeed we'd certainly be very perplexed. We already are very perplexed, but we'd be even more perplexed. So, how ludicrous is it? We're trying to make disempowerment real so that we can defeat it. If it's not real, why do we even need to defeat it? You see, this is the question of enlightenment asks us. Why don't you just recognize it's not real in the first place? Why try to make it real first so that you can claim then you can defeat it? Which, of course, if it was real and you defeated it, you would be disempowering yourself, because you are reality. We are reality. So you see, none of this adds up. So that's why we're very confused deep down. We have this perplexing confusion, like, how do I fit this together? There's nothing to fit. It's just simply accepted. It's impossible to disempower ourselves. The whole conundrum is moot at that point. We can see that if we approach the situation of trying to figure it out schematically, it's ludicrous. How do you approach a ludicrous situation intelligently, except to recognize that it is ludicrous? And then have, laugh and just smile. It's all conflicted. It's all conflicted. And if we don't see this conflict, we will feel driven to figure it out, driven to do something like we feel we've got to, something's wrong, we need to fix something, we need to think about. But when we see the whole basis of this attempt to disempower ourselves, how ludicrous it is, we don't need to do anything. We just simply need to recognize how ludicrous it is. That's it. That's the only doing we need to do. But we can't do this until we bring it to light and look at it. Just look at it. So our real goal is the clarity to bring this to light and just look at it. We just say, look at it. See it? See it for what it is. Don't need to fix anything. Don't need to make it work. Don't need to get rid of the conflict in it. It's inherently conflicted. Totally conflicted. How do we accomplish the impossible? We don't. But when we try to, we're juggling all this stuff, and we're like our mind is feels. We feel as if our mind is something's wrong with our mind. There's nothing wrong with our mind. It's what's wrong. It's the idea of trying to be greater than God. That's what's wrong. What can our mind do but play the shell game? The shell game. And keep hiding the truth, just keep mixing, try to stay confused. So your mind, can calm down, and let the mind calm down. I think someone is agitatedly yelling for me or something. What moment? There you go. Unnecessary disruption. Which is what the world is all about. You see, those who have not brought this to light, the complete ludicrousness of what we're trying to do, how it inherently is completely conflicted goals. Doesn't work, can never work, and must bring about enormous frustration, confusion, and fear. The idea of making disempowerment real so that we can then defeat it and get it would be defeating reality, which would be disempowering ourselves entirely. It's vicious circle, negative, right? Feedback there. lose, lose, lose. Those who don't realize this, are just in this, quandary, and they're trying to constantly find a way, to adapt to this quandary in some intelligent way, but it never quite works. So they never really feel intelligent. It becomes silly, their lives are just folly, just folly, and they're easily distracted because they feel there's this massive quandary and they're supposed to be able to adapt to it, supposed to be able to adapt to it. So they're trying all manner of adaptation. How do we adapt to a quandary, though? Unsolvable quandary, ridiculous quandary. What kind of adaptation? Who wants that? Who wants that? But this is the lies that we all lead, is these ridiculous, farcical adaptations. So the ability to see this quandary for what it is, and just still just full stop in the now of this, wow, this is what we're looking for. This is what we're aiming for. This is what Jesus is aiming for us. He says this is very important. So once we see it like this, what are we left with? Continuity reaction is what we're left with. So there's a price to be paid from all clarity. Is this backlash from the continuity fear? Like, wow, I don't want to be quite that clear about it. It might have some unintended consequences, or not quite ready for that. But keep in mind that there are those who have looked at this and not forgotten to laugh and smile and laugh it off, and that's it, And so they're helping us in some way, somehow, some way they're helping us. Don't really know how they're doing it. Again, our perception is so selective that we have such blinders on, culling out all evidence that disagrees with our conclusions of the sensory apparatus we call a body. It's just a sensory apparatus, really, that is misleading us, totally misleading us. So it's hard for us to know or see or be aware of what it is that, how it is they're helping us. It's frustrating, of course, but we have to have faith that there is, some support, some encouragement, some help somehow. Meanwhile, we continue to be disciplined enough. Now, of course, seeing this in such a casual way, looking at it, as we have done in this video, this quandary, this ridiculous conflict, it is shocking to us, absolutely shocking. Because we're looking at it in a way deeper than academic and intellect here. We're feeling it. We're feeling it. It's very casual, humorous, not structured, so we can't glom on to some structure here. It's very important. That's why these videos seem to be very unstructured. Because what happens, those who are schooled in academia and all that, is they're looking to get an A in the class, to be smart, and they're looking for the structure. Where's the structure? Where's the structure? Where's the form? Where's the structure? Okay, they grab a hold of that. And they don't see the content, really. So what we're doing here is, it's very free form, very spontaneous, no real structure to it. So that we can look beyond the structure and feel the impact of it. Impact, feel the impact. Very impactful. And it can be tiring, absolutely can be tiring, stressful and tiring, of course. But, again, how to spend your time here in this situation, apparent situation, belief in a situation, this believed in a situation we call a world. A situation called planet Earth. A situation called the body. And so those who want to believe that, you know, how are they going to, quote-unquote, spend their time? Well, spend their time recognizing what is this so-called situation really? Or is it just not this ludicrous quandary of conflict? We're hell-bent on making disempowerment real so that we can then defeat it. See, that's the quandary, right? Because so then we're defeating reality, which is our aim in the first place. So very tricky how we hide this aim, our aim, which is to disempower reality, to prove that we're greater. And see, we don't understand that we are reality. We somehow think by disempowering reality, this will somehow result in proving that there's something greater. We are greater. We're greater. And of course, because if you look at this, disempowering reality would be disempowering ourselves, what we are. And how can that make what we are actually greater? It doesn't. It couldn't. You see, reality is all there is. So it's an absurdity from the very beginning. And we fail to recognize the absurdity of it. So we're hell-bent on slay the dragon of disempowerment, you know? Looking, where's the evil? Where's the bad? You know, where's the bad guy? Where are the bad guys? Where's the evil? Where's the disempowerment coming from? And we're hell-bent on, you know, finding it. Okay, this is it. Let's get rid of this. And so you have this world now that is, again, hell-bent on this. Absolutely. And the more we get into that, the more deluded we become. The more delusional. The deeper into delusion we go, and I was shown the future of this world back a ways, about how long ago was that? Maybe a decade or more than a decade ago. And that was what, I don't know, was it 202? Anyways, it was back towards the turn of the century. And I saw going into this period of extreme darkness, extreme delusion, spiritual delusion. It's getting darker and darker and darker. As the more we try to get the bad guys, get rid of darkness, you know, make it real and then defeat it, the more we do that, the more deluded we become, the more dualistically deluded we become. And then the more the continuity fear, you know, strengthens and scares us, actually. And Jesus, his teachings, of course, said, love your enemy, turn the other cheek, resist not evil, all this stuff. I say, what are you talking about? What he's talking about is exactly what we need to hear. The more we try to make disempowerment real in order to defeat it, the more deluded we become. So obviously looking for disempowerment would be looking for our enemy, our adversary, the evil, the bad, the wicked, and defeating them and being anger and righteous, you know, righteous justice and all that stuff. And Jesus said, no, that's not the way, that's the opposite. Realize that nothing can be disempowered. Disempowerment is impossible. Inherently impossible. Therefore, everything that's happening here, we're choosing to have it happen. So we're completely empowered every instant. That's what Jesus says. All is totally empowered every instant. This is God. And there can never be not even one exception to that ever. These teachings came from. Why? So this world right now is hell-bent on tracking down everything that's bad, that's wrong, that's disempowering. Say, okay, we found the real source of disempowerment. Now let's get rid of it, crush it. The more we do this, the less we, the further we are aware, the more defended we are against God, against reality, actually, the more we're denying God. God did not create the possibility of disempowerment. God did not create evil. God did not create wickedness. God did not create any possibility of disempowerment whatsoever. So we're saying that there's something, some dynamic that God did not create, is he? Well, what is the only other possibility? Well, the Son of God, Spirit, must have created it then, right? But God did not give us the capacity to create the dynamic of reality. There's only one dynamic of reality. That's perfect freedom. There's not some second dynamic. So if you listen to Jesus these days, it's not so difficult, you know, it's doable, it's absolutely doable. He's just, after all, just speaking from spirit to spirit, just reminding us of what we are, that's all. Nothing tricky about it. Nothing tricky about that, but what we're trying to do is trick ourselves into thinking that what we're doing is possible. We're definitely trying to trick ourselves. Just let's make disempowerment real and call it evil. And then we'll say, we're trying to get rid of it. That's what we're doing, God. You know, we say, we don't need to listen to God. God, look, we know what we're doing is righteous. We're just trying to get rid of the evil. Get rid of that which is capable of disempowering us. That's all we're trying to do. God, you how can you oppose that? You must not oppose that. We know we're in alignment with you. And we know once we get this done, you will thank us and say, how wonderful my son is to save reality from being destroyed by making disempowerment real and then getting rid of it. This is funny, isn't it? And we expect God to be overjoyed by this and say, oh my gosh, isn't that wonderful? And now you're saved. Of course, if any of this were possible, reality would be annihilated. All of reality would be annihilated. Wouldn't be no such thing if any of this were possible. So it's preposterous. It's all completely preposterous what we're attempting. And yet, we're certainly very serious about it. Very serious about it. Very diligently pursuing this. We've got all the scientists and everybody's technology now. We're looking to find out, you know, where is that evil? Where is that badness? Where is it? We're getting closer and closer to identifying it. Maybe the Ebola virus has something to do with it, we're thinking. Yeah. So, where's the threat? Where's the threat to our power? Trying to isolate that threat. And so, of course, we keep playing with these so-called threats to the body. So we can, you know, try to isolate that threat and defeat it, right? So they ask for volunteers. Any volunteers? They go, volunteers, okay. Yeah, can you volunteer to host this threat in your body and so we can then work on trying to, you know, get you better and save you from it? Or can you help work on helping out, show everybody just how threatening, we need some evidence this is really threatening. So if all you can, you know, your bodies can die and get sick and die from this, that'll help convince us that maybe this is what's really threatening and we can work on this. And so we say, well, we're progressively getting rid of the threat. You know, we've conquered this illness and this illness and this illness, and we're working on exterminating this illness. And so gradually, we're bit by bit, we're dissembling this terrible threat to reality. And we feel like we're on a crusade. You know, we're crusaders saving reality from some sort of awful external threat that is capable of disempowering it. Like we're soldiers on the front line here, sacrificing our bodies in order to save God, save reality. Meanwhile, all along, all we're doing is using our power to make believe and pretend that we're that there's an element that we're some threat to our power. We're using our power to pretend there's a threat to our power. That's all we're doing. Now, there's not many people in the world listening, watching these videos, or listening to these videos. That's okay. But I certainly feel this is helping me align with the teachings of Jesus for sure. So it's very beneficial. It's very beneficial. The numbers don't ultimately determine how beneficial something is. People have forgotten how to drive. Yeah, there's so many accidents because they're so used to sunny weather. They get the habit of driving like suicide kamikaze drivers, weaving around and switching so fast and close tolerances. You know, it's nuts the way they're driving. And then when it starts, a storm comes, they're so used to driving this way that they tend to keep driving this way. And we just had like a horrible Bay Area just did. There's like hundreds and hundreds of accidents yesterday. Someone said like 400 accidents. Because hopefully the day's not as bad. But it shows you how familiarity is very powerful. We tend to be on autopilot and continue to act the way we're used to acting, even though conditions have changed. It's hard to change your style of driving. It really is very difficult. So what I do is, it's raining, just relax, be calm, don't be in a hurry, be very mellow, and just so you just give yourself, you don't go so fast, give yourself space, and just. But that's how I normally drive. So if I don't know if I'm really aggressive people, I don't know, you know, they're getting in trouble. Slow down. Like I was going on the freeway, and it was raining so hard. There was water pooling on the freeway, and so you go through these pools and you hydroplane through them, just hydroplaning. And when you're hydroplaning, you know, you're just going straight. And when the freeway is turning, you know, and if you're going through a pool and then someone next to you is not, and then you're just going straight. I mean, you're going into them. You're going into the car, right? Because they're turning on the freeway, going, curving on the freeway. You're going straight. So you got to slow down. So probably a lot of hydroplaning has been taking place. So I would say the next 18 months may be like a hydroplaning time. Right, where no brakes. I mean, the brakes don't work. You're just people just be hydroplaning on autopilot. You know, and people are so used to certain beliefs now, dualistic beliefs of righteousness, and they've sort of forgotten the teachings of Jesus, which was the whole point of this really big business in the world, is to get us to forget the teachings of Jesus, which are extremely important teachings. They're not the only teachings that can be taught, but they're extremely important. Extremely important. Central. Designed to help us with this situation that's happening in the world now. They were designed to help us with this. Resist not evil. Love your enemy. Turn the other cheek. Don't go on a witch hunt. Don't go on a crusade for evil. To get rid of evil, to you know, by realize that disempowerment is impossible. No wrong has ever happened. There's never been a wrong that ever happened. There's never been a right that ever happened either. That's why Jesus said, don't call me good. What do you mean good? Good and bad, what's that? There's never been any good happen. There's never been any bad happen. There's only been perfect empowerment happening, always. Perfect power expressing itself, always. So imagine if there's, like today, there was all these thunderstorms, and you might be driving along and it's dry. Yeah, it's fine. And then this is what happened to me. And then I was up ahead, it looked real dark, and you drive into it, and it was just coming down in buckets, flooding the freeway. So, and then that passes through. So you may be driving along, and you come upon this, and everything seems fine. Everything's fine. It's driving real fast. And then you come across an area where a thunderstorm just hit, and there's all this water on the freeway, and you're going real fast, and you just suddenly start hydroplaning. It just hits you like that. Now, what if somebody told you, hey, slow down. There's been an extensive storm up ahead, and there's water all over the freeway. Better slow down and get used to driving slower. So, you know, don't wait until you hit it, because then it's too late, because then you're already hydroplaning, and you have no control of your vehicle. You turn the wheels, the brake, nothing works. So someone tells you on the radio, hey, in this section of road, slow down. This is like Jesus 2,000 years ago telling us there's going to be this, you know, there's this huge storm that's going to hit the world, and it's going to put the world into hydroplane mode. And you have to then have slowed down, in other words, slowed down your whole attachment to this world, your value of this world, investing in this ridiculous crusade to try and make illusions real and then destroy them. And say, thereby save reality by destroying it. Slow down from this. Right? Start disengage from death, disengage from this nonsense. So that when you come across the pool, the water's all pooled now, all this precipitation has come down. You go through it slowly, you won't be hydroplaning, you'll still have control. So absolutely, as the song goes, turn the radio on and listen to the station where the gospel is, the good news is, we can slow down. We can disengage from this. We don't have to continue this ridiculous crusade to save reality from itself by destroying it, which can't be done. But when we think it can't be done, it becomes extremely confusing to us. So we're warned ahead of time. It's like that. Someone who knows the weather up ahead, if you have Doppler radar, you can see where the stuff is and see how intense it is. You can warn the motorists, say, hey, you know, in this certain section of this freeway, there's an inundation taking place, right? So you may be 5 minutes, 10 minutes from it. In Jesus' case, we might be several thousand years away from this inundation, but he has this sort of spiritual Doppler radar, is able to see. Oh yeah, up ahead on this road that you're going towards in a couple thousand years, you'll run into this massive inundation of really big business interests wanting to turn you into sheeple. And you better have slowed down before you hit that. Otherwise, you're going to hydroplane right into their jaws, into the jaws of darkness. Be able to turn off, you know, the freeway. Like, oh, if you're going slow enough, you say, whoa, this is inundated here. Let me turn off. Go the side route. It's not so bad, right? If you're going too fast, you just hydroplane right into the darkness. What is the darkness? The effort to defeat the darkness is the darkness, actually. The effort to defeat the darkness is the darkness. Very tricky, isn't it? Because it says the darkness is real. And that saying the darkness is real is the darkness. And if darkness isn't real, why are we trying to defeat it? So trying to defeat darkness is tacitly saying, this premise is, darkness is real. Right? It's absolutely not worry about defeating it at all. So, the desire to defeat darkness is the darkness. The belief that darkness is real is the darkness. If it's not real, right? Why would you want to defeat it? Think it needs to be defeated? This is ridiculous. It has zero power. If it's not real, it has no power. Only reality has power. Nothing real exists. Nothing unreal exists. Only reality is real, and nothing unreal exists. So why would you think that you needed to defeat it, unless you thought it was real? If it's not real, it has zero power. So how can you be threatened? How can we be threatened by what has no power at all? People say, well, no, we're open to religious spiritual discussion, of course. Well, are they open to this type of discussion? Because this is actually a real spiritual discussion. Much of what takes place in the world is just not wasted time, nonsense. The desire to defeat darkness is the darkness. The desire to defeat delusion is the delusion. It's the delusion that there's some power to delusion. The belief that there's some power to darkness. There's zero power, no power at all. Because there's no such thing as disempowerment. How can there be then this darkness that has the power of disempowerment? There isn't any such situation. So then why do we believe we need to defeat something? And there isn't anything that needs to be defeated. Jesus came into the world at a time where most of the teachings were profoundly dualistic. Most of them, a lot of the prevailing ideologies, Zoroastrianism, Manichaeism, were some of the teachings, very, very strong teachings that had been disseminated throughout the empires. Old Persian empires there, and that whole area, you know, of the Middle East, and then of course the Buddhist and Vedic teachings were basically non-dual, if understood correctly, were non-dual. But people struggled with understanding non-dual teaching. But for much of the world, you know, the Greek empires, the Roman Empire, all of this super dualistic. So Jesus' teachings work to and begin to raise us out of this madness. And now we're at a time here where the world is sunk in very bad dualism. The whole world, everyone's a bunch of crusaders in this world, actually. A bunch of crusaders. We think the Middle Ages had a bunch of crusaders. We criticize the Middle Ages for being dark time. That's nothing compared to what the times are now. We have an entire planet full of rabid crusaders who are chomping at the bit to deal with evil, you know, get rid of non-dualism. They think it's threatening their capacity to be triumph, heroic triumph, you know, of getting them bad, you know, finding who's bad. So, you know, you see, make some tweet on Twitter, and the Twitterverse, you know, doesn't like it. You know, oh my God, the condemnation comes down, and oh, I must delete my account and I profusely apologize. I said something the Twitterverse doesn't like, you know. Facebook, the same thing. All of the social media, right? The pressure on social media that people believe in. It's from my standpoint, it's completely completely humorous and ludicrous. This is the situation of a world full of rabid crusaders. They're all on crusades. They must slay the dragon of darkness. You know, somebody said something they didn't like. Oh, there's the darkness. We found it now. Hey, everybody, I must tell all my friends instantly. Is this a network of friends? The people I have on Facebook, this is all their friends, really? Twitter accounts, is that, those are our friends. So, no, those are our co-crusaders. Those are the co-crusaders, the ones that are on the crusade with us, you know. So I must immediately inform them. I located the dragon, I located the infidel, I located the apostate, the evil ones. I located something, you know, bad. And we need to... We must mobilize, and we must attack and rid the world of this evil. And that's what's going on. So global crusade is taking place. This is plunging the planet into extreme spiritual darkness. Quote unquote the planet. I mean all of the consciousness that imagines itself is imagining itself in this scenario. This is what in large measure is plunging. There's other measures too that are plunging us, which is the it's almost like politics and corporations are all now, it's all sort of a gestalt, holistic gestalt of this really big business, which is, again, really big business in this world and from other places outside this world, together with the politics of this world, together with some of the religious situations, all combined with the social media consciousness and all of this, and the PC, and the activists, and the special interest, all of this stuff is coalesces into one situation, one juggernaut, one massive crusade to once and for all identify the threat to reality and destroy it. And you have a planet of knuckleheads, essentially, knuckle draggers, you know, into a super severe dark age. You know, the final solution. We finally found the final solution. We've meld all of us together into one huge united crusade. We are united in our zeal to finally identify the threat to reality and remove it once and for all. This is the world now. This is the world now. So you have to keep laughing. I have to keep laughing because, again, it's done with such zeal. You know, and everybody's so... I see this happen, you know, like in this Twitter stuff or whatever. It seems like every day somebody's being whacked down, you know, and they delete their account. You know, I said something that, whoops, I must delete my account. I must not exist. I can't exist anymore in this world. That way, you know... This is like totally weird, totally bizarre. For my generation, like the idea of that, you know, is just completely ludicrous and bizarre. Oh, I lost all my friends. My friends are gonna, I'll lose all my friends, and, you know. So everybody's like, you know, really scared to say anything, you know, that the crusaders don't like. But it's getting so virulent, you know, that we may need to sidestep it. Even those of us who have not forgotten to laugh at it, laugh at the ludicrous absurdity and quandary of dualistic delusion of trying to be greater than God, separating from God, and what we're juggling all this stuff. We might even need to sidestep this at some point because the crusade might just, you know, become so rabid that you know, rabid dog doesn't know what it's doing. It'll bite anybody. The world. It's like, I accuse. And everybody's just looking for someone to accuse, really. Just looking for someone to accuse. And of course, the heroes are the ones who point out, there they are, I have located them. Send up some what do you call it? Some drone, you know, is seeking for someone to accuse. And now we got these bots crawling the internet. They'll probably start identifying various, you know, users of the internet who to accuse. And family and friends will say, oh my gosh, right in our own household, we have some terrible threat to reality lurking. Because someone who doesn't believe that reality is threatened, that's a big threat to reality. Because of course reality is threatened, they say. And it's our job. God hasn't put us on a mission. Our whole mission that God gave us is to defeat this threat and save reality. And that's what our whole purpose is all about. You know, that's what our purpose is all about. And that's what the spirits believing and coming to this world. A lot of spirits believe we're on a mission from God to defeat the evil, you know, what's bad, what's wrong, what's evil, we must defeat it. And once we defeat it, then God will praise us and we'll be able to dwell in heaven forever with God, forgetting the fact that what's real is all that is totally empowered, always. And what is not real has zero empowerment whatsoever. So there couldn't possibly be any mission to destroy what doesn't has no reality. Nothing. Destroy nothing. You know, God is not threatened by nothing. So there couldn't possibly be any mission to... God wouldn't put us on a mission to destroy reality, something as real. Because that would be destroying real God. So we're saying God put us on a mission to destroy God, and once we destroy God, then God will bring us up to heaven and we'll all be happy, you know. It's ludicrous, right? Totally ludicrous. And again, the ability to just laugh at this is very important, otherwise you'll start thinking about it. And that you'll get into this real heavy trip, which I used to be on. Because I was taught, you're supposed to think about everything and figure it out. You have to, you know, take it all seriously. So it's serious, so I became very serious. It's very serious. It's very serious. Super, uber serious. I said, how? You know, because I was trying to make it. What's the structure here? You know, it's no structure. It's all ludicrous. What kind of structure does ludicrousness have to it? There's no real structure at all. So. When you see there's no structure, what else can you do except chuckle about it? You know, what structure does nothing have, actually? What structure does nothing have? So the more you're into your mind about structure, the more difficult it is to just laugh at nothing and just say, oh, you know, nothing, just laugh and that's it. Just disengage from nothing. See, the great gurus look at you with a smile. You see, you feel the smile, and they're laughing with you. And it may appear to be serious at times because the world wants them. Then they, okay, I'm trying to confuse, but they're beaming. They're blissfully beaming this total unconcern. You know, it's like, how do we defeat the structure of nothing is what the world is trying to figure out. How do we defeat the structure of nothing? And everyone's very serious. I think I have some clues about this. We're running the data, crunching the numbers right now. And we'll see how it turns out. We do have a couple of supercomputers, bigger and bigger ones, and better ones coming online very soon. And we'll start really crunching the numbers, get down to business there. You know. And we'll see what we come up with there. In the meantime, you know, let's keep serious, keep working on it, keep trying to figure it out here. And we got some promising leads, and I think we probably should figure it out pretty soon here what the structure of nothing really is here. And once we figure out the structure of Nuggetius, we'll really be able to disassemble it, right? Get rid of it. Figure out how to reverse engineer the structure of nothing so that we're not so threatened by it. Got a little stream here, it's nice. And the thing is, we're so conditioned, then once we stop with this lightening up, we'll go back into a more serious mode. Serious and crushed. And I can't figure out the structure of nothing. I'm such a loser, you know. I'm such a loser. I'm not worth living anymore. I can't figure it out. Everybody else has seemed very successful. They got some clues, you know. They've got a direction in life. They seem to have got a hold of something, at least, you know, some structure of nothing. And here I am, I can't even find any structure, nothing. Boy, I'm really being left in the dust, you know. Becoming extinct, you know. As the progress roars on towards this ultimate goal of actually figuring it all out. And then once we figure it all out, then we'll have this golden age, and God will come to earth, and we'll all party and be beautiful, you know, be wonderful. We finally figured out the structure of nothing. We destroyed it. Saved reality from nothing. And we will have earned God's eternal gratitude for ourselves in doing that. So here I'm thinking, like, oh my God, God will never have any gratitude to me. I never did anything. You know, I never worked on figuring it out. I didn't try to help this great crusade and this great effort to, you know, to figure out the structure of nothing and to destroy it. And so I won't have any place in heaven. You know, I'll be kept out of a kingdom, and God won't even have anything to do with me. I'll be isolated and alone. Yeah, these are the thoughts of serious. I get so depressed. You know, get so depressed. It's easy to get depressed here on the spiritual path because, you know, you're saying, wait a minute, I don't think there's anything I need to do or can be done. You know, and you think, oh gosh, I'm going to miss out on all the awards, and God won't even know me. I don't even know you. You didn't save me from this terrible problem. You didn't take part in this mission. I told you this was your purpose. I created you in order to save reality from nothing, and you didn't do it, and you finally backed out of it, and it's got I've got to uncreate you because you're defective. You know, you're defective. You didn't follow my will. And this is the script that's playing in our belief system, the script where we're hearing this deep down, and so we're like jittery and nervous. Thinking, holy cow, I better get used to depression, because that's what's coming for me. I better get used to isolation, because that's what's coming for me. I better get used to being isolated, excluded, ostracized, depressed, with no acknowledgement, no connection to God, anything. Just, you know, I better get used to that in some remote icy place in space where I'm just completely, I better get used to that. So maybe we even start feeling that, trying to feel that way, because I think I need to get used to that because that's what's going to happen to me. Interesting, huh? But this shows how spiritual truth can lift us out of this, because we don't need to start play acting the scenario of isolation, because it won't happen, never will happen. In fact, God is delighted with us, you say, and by giving up this ridiculous charade of trying to figure out the structure of nothing and then defeat it. But this is the interplay of, so I can go from this like really spiritual buzz, you know, to severe depression, you know, like back and forth kind of thing. Maybe I'm mistaken, or at least there won't be nobody going along with where I am, so I'll be isolated or something. But, so that's the trouble on the path for sure, as you start recognizing what's going on here. Wait a minute. And then there's this little concern, and concern arises. But how can we be isolated from our empowerment, our power and empowerment, which is all power? So if we have all power, how can we be isolated? What can isolate us? God can't isolate us, because we have all the power that God has. With the exception, we can't change that fact. We can't change the fact that we have all the power that God has. See? So how can we be isolated from God? It's impossible. How can we be isolated from anything? From the allness? It's not possible. Light is totally our faithful servant. That can never change. The ones who are trying to isolate themselves are the ones working on trying to defeat this, you know, this evil. They're the ones who are trying to isolate themselves. But since they have this totally coherent group, you know, we're all in this together, this crusade together, it, you know, it doesn't seem that way. It seems like this is where the party is, you know, a big crusade. What we're really worried about is that somehow the structure of nothing will be discovered and will be then destroyed, and reality be destroyed, and those who destroyed reality will somehow then continue on, you know. that's also at play, along with this continuity fear, continuity problem. Like, yeah, I know this is all ridiculous, but I'm sort of afraid to drop it all. So this is all part of just lightening up, lightening up, lightening up, lightening up. And we need to lighten up, because this crusade is likely to really, really, really take on a life of its own. You know, just like in the crusades in the Middle Ages, one knight, you know, would take up the call to crusade. You know, liberate the Holy Land. You know, so. You know, they get some ships, and their little fiefdom will get into it, and then some other knight, you know, some other fiefdom or principality will get into it, and a few more, and then they'd go, and then the word would come back like, hey, we need reinforcements. This is very difficult. You know, eventually, it took on sort of this mania. Okay, eventually it reached like a point of mania. So you have to understand, throughout history, this world has gone into manic phases, mania phases, of crusade mania. And it comes very suddenly, you know, it can suddenly grip us here. It has over and over and over and over and over. And then everyone says, hey, this is our purpose in life. Everyone suddenly discovers their purpose in life. And that's what we've been told. There's going to be this shift in consciousness, blah, blah, blah. What it could very well mean is that everyone here thinks that they suddenly discover their purpose in life. This could very well be coming in the next 18 months. This is what I'm saying. Or at least that the final push for this could be coming in the next 18 months. You know, really the rollout starts happening. Is that collectively the planet suddenly thinks that we've all discovered what our purpose is, which is what? To identify the threat and evil and get rid of it, of course. And everyone said, oh my gosh, this is what I came here for. Now I know. And everyone will think there's a global awakening happening. We've been taught this, that this is actually part of a plan of a really big business. The great, really big business alliance is to give this false sense of enlightenment and salvation. Very false, which is this crusader mentality of like, I finally discovered my purpose in life. Yeah, just get rid of the bad guys. Yeah, of course. And it's like global epiphany or something. Everyone thinks that they're waking up. And everyone thinks that, oh, this is it. the global enlightenment is happening. The golden age is almost here, because as soon as we figure out the structure of nothing, figure out the structure of evil and destroy it, we'll be saved in golden age. So okay, my purpose here is now I know. So it'll be like the whole planet's like waking up. We've been told this over and over and over and over. Like the whole planet at some point is going to wake up. This is delusion. This is the delusion that has very cleverly been fostered here by a really big business alliance. And that's exactly what turns people into sheeple, because then they lose sight of the path to the true understanding of non-duality. They lose sight of it altogether, because now they're righteous. They're righteous dualists, you know. They're crusaders now. So this could very well happen. I expect it will happen. It's been primed. The whole world's been primed for this, actually. And it can easily work its way through society, and then a mania will begin to spread. And like I said, it's contagious. This is this virus, a very bad virus. And it'll seem like the planet has suddenly shifted. And people say, this is the shift we've been waiting for. This is the shift of the ages. This is the shift that such and such talked about. This is Jesus must be coming back. This is, you know, this is the planetary salvation. We've suddenly shifted into a higher frequency here, and we've now become part of this greater cosmos, and we have this now cosmic awareness. And you know, this is all the deceit of this really big business alliance that is telling us that, you know, once we make this planetary shift, then we have cosmic awareness, and then these outside influences can interact with us, and we'll all be trading and bigger business and bigger commerce and expand our horizons, and there's a golden age. We're told all this stuff, you know. And it will be the sudden realization, oh, this is my purpose. Now I understand. I'm a good person. I'm a crusader. I'm righteous. And I have now have the tools to participate in this great cosmic campaign to get rid of the darkness, get rid of the evil, you know, this great Manichaean, even Gnostic campaign. You know, the Arjons, I don't know what they call them, but this terrible force that has been threatening reality and God for so long. Finally, I'm part of the crusade. Wow. The whole planet is now part. We've been lifted up higher. Our vibration is higher. We're a spiritual planet now. And now the great masters and goddesses and all, you know, can come down to the planet and dwell among us. And because we're now worthy. We're worthy of it. We've discovered our mission, our purpose of the mission that God gave us. So representatives of God will be among us, you know. No, those are the representatives of the really big business interest is what's going to be among us. Very clever deceit, but not that clever, really. Pretty simplistic once you see it, isn't it? Worthy of only a chuckle or a laugh, actually. It's so silly. I remember visiting with Jesus, talking with Jesus, and I was asleep, body was asleep, my consciousness was visiting, and he didn't have a worry at all. There was no like seriousness or concern or worry at all. No, you're completely full of, you can tell, just relaxed and full of good humor and everything. In other words, he sees the whole thing. He sees what's going on. And from his perspective, of course, it's all completely ludicrous. And it's no threat to reality whatsoever. So his perspective on it doesn't pull him down into seriousness at all. No, it does not. He only wants to, his mission is to bring us up to the point where we see this, so we can have a good laugh too. So he can hardly be all the serious concern, oh wow, you know, this is the kind of way. No, he's blissful, relaxed, peaceful, not worried at all, so to bring us up, so we can see it that way. Absolutely. This is what the great teachers do. So, now we know. What's going on? Now we know what's going on here. I've always known this, but I couldn't really express it clearly in a way that the world that we can understand. But now I'm able to do that. it has to be, of course, laughter involved and the level of being lifted up, lightened up, so we don't take it seriously at all. You know, we see it's completely non-serious. But as Jesus says, everyone is like so intensely in playing their roles, you know, so such intensity and passion, everything. He says, it's great, you know, it's fine, no problem. Act it out, play it out, no worries, no problem. There's no such thing as any disempowerment. So he's not worried about disempowerment. See, there's no disempowerment ever taking place. So how could you think Jesus is really worried? Like, wow, I hope that the forces of darkness don't prevail here, you know? I hope the forces of delusion is really a trouble here. And there's no problem of disempowerment whatsoever. It's completely impossible. So, now Jesus, I didn't feel any concern with him at all. No concern. No concern. Everything's perfect. No way it could be any other way. And then I go away and say, huh? I think, like, wow, how come Jesus isn't worried? I see all this stuff happening. This is terrible, you know, stuff. Well, pragmatically, you might say there's some pragmatic issues, but that doesn't raise to the level of concern, spiritual concern. No. So it's not anything to get pulled down spiritually by hell. It should not affect the bliss, the self-releaseness, you know, the feeling of this. No problem whatsoever, really. Except the continuity problem as a practical situation. But not something that affects the belief in that you're threatened at all. Not the level of threat at all. Not the threat of isolation. Not the threat of ostracism. Not the threat of stuff. No threat. So the way I experienced Jesus was there's no sense of threat in him whatsoever. No sense of threat at all. But he's certainly aware of the world and what's going on and that kind of stuff. But it's completely simple. See, it is actually completely simple. He's not like thinking like, wow, there's a really complex scenario unfolding here. I got to figure that out or something. No, it's a piece of cake. It's completely simple. There's just this false salvation, you know, taking place to mislead ourselves so we can, you know, can continue on with this funny charade for a little while longer. That is great. So obviously, if you want to be in the presence of Jesus, you can't be the go flip into like super serious and morose and question, oh, wait a minute, Jesus, now what exact steps are you taking? How come, what is threatening? Now, can you tell me how to defeat this? You know, you can't be in that mode at all because you wouldn't get the answers you're looking for. So you need to be in the mode of lightening up and seeing how silly it is now. Simple and silly. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. And go more and more towards that mode. That's what I say to my experiences. So in other words, we don't forget to laugh. We don't forget to laugh. That's very important. Laugh at the silliness of it all. Well, this has been quite something. I didn't expect it to go in this direction. It's just, you know, freeform, spontaneous. Just keep working, see what comes up. Wow. This is what has come up. This is very, very significant, right? But keep it light, keep it simple. Keep it like he said. So full stop in the now of this wow. Like it really is simple. It really is basic, right? It really is. Don't make it more of it than you need to. Don't start thinking about it. Don't start thinking. Just stay. Say, feel okay. Everything's okay. No worries. It's very simple. What's taking place? This false salvation where everyone in the world suddenly realizes, hey, I've discovered my purpose. I realize why I exist, why I'm here. You know, but I'm to be a crusader. Okay, it's very simple. They're doing exactly the trap, falling into the trap that's been set for them, which they really have set for themselves. That's all, right? No one's being disempowered. You know, this is what their agenda they're going along with, trying to be greater than God. And where do you go if all is totally empowered and you want to be different than that? How do you differentiate yourself from that? Through the idea of disempowerment, of course. So that's just continuing to play out in its silliness, is all. I just accept this. Oh, it's just playing out in its silliness. There's a big play, but there's a big play coming for sure. Or the whole planet suddenly discovers, yeah, the mania. You discovered our purpose. And there may be these big masters thing, you know, people come out and you know, ignite this mania. You know, you discover the purpose that God has for us. And finally we have the tools to really, you know, stamp out these evils that are taking place in the world. And you know, this is, and then this, everyone will start feeling really righteous and think they're saved. You know, this is a stampede, mania. And, you know, we could all get swept up in that, for sure, myself included. Who could say they could, you know, will not get swept up in it? So, we need to certainly turn towards truth and the grace of God and ask for help so we don't get swept up in this. So I'm trying to do my part here to lighten the load, to lighten the whole thing up, lighten the whole thing up, lighten it all up. Don't get caught in that morose seriousness. And now you wonder why I don't have a smartphone and that kind of stuff. Yeah. Not active on Facebook, not active on Twitter, not active on social media. Just as yet. You gotta disengage from this nonsense. You know, you cannot get swept up in it. Smartphone is your tool, the dumbness, actually. Yes, absolutely. It's your portal into dumbness. But the real thing, it's the portal into this global renaissance, consciousness shift, vibrational shift, golden age, spiritual awakening on the planet. You know, that's what everybody thinks. Everybody thinks that, yeah, this is how we're going to do it. Pathway to salvation is what people believe. So false salvation is, and so following this false salvation is plunging into darkness is what it really is. All the while thinking that they're there to defeat darkness, they don't realize the desire to defeat darkness is the darkness. So the more they desire to defeat darkness, the more they darkness there seems to be, you know, and they can't figure it out, you know, it just seems like, and then they feel more and more righteous, like, wow, look at this, the darkness is really resisting me, they think, because I'm so righteous, it's all coming up now, so I can defeat it all at once. That's a tough path for sure. So you have to come back and eventually be attracted to the laughter where you can just laugh and say, oh, that was silly. How ridiculous that was. And then let it go. It's just that simple. It's how ridiculous that was. Let it go. Okay. Very great. All thanks to all the help that is present. Absolutely. Okay, that's it for this one.